Good afternoon. The first item of business today is portfolio questions. We start with question number one, Gil Paterson.
Many thanks, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how much West Dunbartonshire has received as a result of the cashback for community scheme.
Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson.
Young people from West Dunbartonshire have directly benefited from over £890,000 of cashback investment from 2008 to 2016, delivering almost 33,000 activities and opportunities up to March 2026. Phase 4 of cashback started on the 1st of April 2017 and will run until the 31st of March 2020. We have invested some £17 million across 17 exciting new programmes that are even more focused on disadvantaged young people in every local authority across Scotland. This will build on the success of the cashback programme to date.
Gil Paterson.
May I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that reply? Can the Cabinet Secretary give further details on how many activities this scheme has funded both in West Dunbartonshire and across Scotland as a whole, and what the priorities are for the Cashback for Communities initiative?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, as I mentioned earlier on, between 2008 and 2016, we have delivered almost 33,000 activities and opportunities within the West Dunbartonshire area. And across Scotland, we have delivered nearly 2 million free, positive, healthy opportunities and activities for young people to participate in. The £17 million Phase 4 cashback programme started on the 1st of April this year and involves some 17 partner organisations delivering for young people across the country. The Phase 4 cashback programme has an even stronger focus on areas of deprivation and disadvantaged young people. This strong focus on disadvantaged young people will help to contribute towards our aim of tackling inequality by raising their attainment, ambition and their aspiration. I very much agree with the member that cashback does give young people the chance to get creative and to broaden their horizons by taking part in a range of different activities and opportunities. We are providing opportunities for young people to get involved and to improve their confidence and to improve their sense of achievement. Investment in our young people and in their communities through cashback, in my view, Presiding Officer, is money well spent.
Maurice Corrie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I note that the large proportion of the cashback for community schemes in West Dunbartonshire goes to sports-related projects. Would the Cabinet Secretary consider a more even spread to other community schemes who were very worthwhile in West Dunbartonshire?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the member will recognise that sport is a key component of the programme that we have within cashback, but we also have the creative programme and the 17 different programmes that we're now going to be taking forward with a range of national organisations will deliver and tailor programmes specific to those local areas. So, for example, some of them are involving outdoor activities that are not sport-related as such, but will involve participating in our types of programmes. So I see this week, the first of the experience in going sailing through the Youth Ocean Going Training Programme is taking place, where young people from the borders are participating in that. So there's a range of different programmes that will not only be delivered within West Dunbartonshire, but will be delivered in other parts of Scotland that young people from West Dunbartonshire will be able to participate in as well. So the 17 different organisations we've given funding for will then be responsible for looking how that's delivered at a local level and also making sure that where it's a national programme, that people from areas such as West Dunbartonshire get the opportunity to participate in those programmes.
Question number two, Tom Arthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I remind the Chamber that I am the Parliamentary Liaison Officer to the Cabinet Secretary. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to ensure that police stations are resourced to support people with mental health problems.
There is increasing recognition of the key role that police play in supporting people who are vulnerable or in distress, including people with mental health conditions. The draft Policing 2026 strategy, recently published for consultation by Police Scotland and the Scottish Police Authority, emphasises the importance of a partnership approach in providing effective support to people with mental health conditions. There are already very good examples of collaboration between Police Scotland and NHS partners to improve the response and service to people in distress or suffering from mental health difficulties. For example, community trial services, which provide officers with an hour of hours service to community psychiatric nurses, are already operating in the Glasgow area and in Edinburgh, and several other areas across Scotland are developing similar services. The Scottish Government's mental health strategy contains an action to increase the mental health workforce to give access to dedicated mental health professionals in a number of key settings, including the police service. In order to meet this commitment, the Scottish Government will increase additional investment to £35 million over the next 5 years, and this will pay for 800 additional mental health workers in these settings.
Tom Arthur.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? Given that as many as 80% of incidents attended by Police Scotland are non-criminal call-outs, including responding to vulnerable individuals and individuals with mental health conditions, does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that the provision of a dedicated mental health professionals to police stations across Scotland will be an invaluable addition to local policing?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Presiding Officer, it's important that vulnerable individuals, particularly individuals who may be in distress or experiencing mental ill health, that they get the right support at the appropriate time when they contact one of our emergency services, including the police service. That's why the additional investment which we're putting into the mental health workforce will help to support increasing capacity to assist the police in addressing issues relating to mental ill health. It is also, Presiding Officer, worth noting the significant work that Police Scotland are already taking forward. Last week I had the privilege of visiting Police Scotland's 5th Divisional Headquarters in Glenrothes and was able to see firsthand the excellent work being undertaken to equip officers and staff with the skills to support people who have mental ill health or are experiencing distress. And Police Scotland are leading the way in this with the training of all of their officers up to the rank of inspector, which will involve the training of some 17,500 officers, which will be completed by May of this year, all being trained and equipped with the knowledge and the skills to be able to work with individuals who may be experiencing mental ill health and distress and to be able to respond to that in an appropriate and effective way.
Question 3, Elaine Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission regarding the 12.5% increase in the solicitor levy.
Minister Annabel Ewing.
I draw members' attention, Presiding Officer, to my entry in the Register of Members' Interest, where they will find that I am a solicitor by profession and hold a current practising certificate, albeit that I do not practise. Officials met with the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission on 9th March of this year to discuss the background to its proposed budget. The Scottish Legal Complaints Commission is an independent statutory body and operates independently of both the Scottish Government and the legal profession. It is for the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission to determine the annual levy to be paid by the legal profession in accordance with legislation. Scottish ministers have no statutory powers regarding the Commission and hence have no statutory role in operational matters.
Elaine Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thanks to the Minister for that response. But I think it will be rather disappointing to the many constituents who have approached me and no doubt other colleagues hoping that the matter can be raised in Parliament, some action might be able to be taken. And it might be rather confusing for them to hear that answer, since in 2010, the Minister for Community Safety, Fergus Ewing, MSP, wrote to the SLCC at that time expressing strong views on the proposed increase in the solicitor levy. So my question would be, why can the Scottish Government not do so now, particularly given the Law Society of Scotland's remarks that this increase is unacceptable, and also given that at that time Fergus Ewing also said that ministers would review the situation and they would see whether any changes in the respective power of ministers and the Commission is desirable?
Minister.
I thank the member for her supplementary question. I would point out to the member that, in fact, Scottish Government officials have written to the Chief Exec of the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission, indeed to raise the concerns that have been raised recently by members of the profession in particular, concerning, amongst other things, issues to do with governance, approach to efficiencies, and the extent of non-core activities. So that letter has gone to the Chief Exec of the SLCC and we await his response. On the wider issue of looking at the system as a whole and how it can be made to function better and to wider acceptance. The member may be aware that we announced yesterday the launch of an independent review of the regulation of legal services, which of course reflected a manifesto commitment to review the regulation of the legal profession. And within that review, of course, the complaint system is made up of a number of processes and actors, one of which is the SLCC. And of course, reviewers, further to this independent review, will be able to investigate what changes to the system they feel will be required in order to strengthen public trust in the system and indeed to modernise this and simplify the system and the regulatory structure underpinning that.
Gordon Lyndhurst.
I would remind members of my register of interest and the fact that I am a practising advocate subject to the SLCC levy. My question to the Minister is this: as part of the independent review, will the question of some mechanism whereby the SLCC levy setting be subject itself to independent review? Because it would seem somewhat ironic that a body meant to look independently and objectively at complaints against members of the legal profession should be able to set such a levy without reference to independent consideration of what the appropriate levy is.
Yes. I would respond by reminding the member that, of course, the statutory framework that we're talking about was introduced further to the Legal Profession and Legal Aid Scotland Act 2007, which was passed in this Parliament on the 14th of December 2006. And it was that Act that provided for the fact that the Scottish ministers have no statutory role in the operation of the Commission. Looking to the future, a potential future, and the independent review of the regulation of legal services. Of course, it will be a matter for the chair of the review, Esther Robertson, and her panel to consider all issues that they feel are relevant within the terms of reference set. And I would refer the member to the inspired parliamentary question that was answered yesterday for the full detail of the review.
Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given that setting the SLCC levy is not a matter the Scottish Government has a role in, does the Minister agree that both parties agreeing to attend a meeting last week to discuss the issue further was a positive step which enabled further discussion and an opportunity for the SLCC and Law Society to present their concerns directly with one another?
Minister.
Well, I was aware of Rona Mackay's excellent initiative, and I do commend the action that she took in seeking to facilitate ongoing dialogue as between the SLCC and the, in particular, the Law Society of Scotland. As the member will have heard, there have been a number of initiatives over the last few days to seek to move this issue forward and to look to the future in terms of how we improve our statutory regulatory framework in the years ahead. But I do commend the action that the member took at her own initiative to try to move this issue forward.
Question number four, Tavish Scott.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how effective emergency control rooms are in recognising island geography.
Cabinet Secretary.
The emergency services use a number of different tools to support them in the identification of incident locations. It is these tools, alongside extensive training and utilisation of local knowledge held by response units, which support the delivery of prompt and effective services to members of the public across the country, including our island communities.
Tavish Scott.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that the Scottish Ambulance Service managed to send a plane to Shetland rather than to Orkney of late, and there have been a number of incidents with regard to the fire control systems, emergency response systems, including calling out the fire service in the island of Bressey when it should have been in the island of Yell. Would you be prepared to at least undertake an examination of the merits of a joint control emergency system for the islands that didn't have to encounter these kind of problems?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Presiding Officer, as a member will be aware, there has been significant preparatory work going into the changes to the operational control arrangements for the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service in Scotland. And the member met in recent times with the Chief Fire Officer, Alistair Hay, in order to discuss some of his concerns regarding the incident which he made reference to. It is worth keeping in mind that there has always been an element within the way in which operational control has been provided by some of our emergency services, that the geographical location of the actual contact centre in itself is not the key issue. It is the knowledge of the staff and the tools and equipment which they have within that particular facility that is important in making sure that resources are deployed to the appropriate area. Just by way of illustration of that, the Scottish Fire and Rescue Control Centre in Johnston, before it took in the Dumfries area, once we moved to a single fire service, it was covering almost 50% of the calls which were coming into the fire service in Scotland, primarily to Strathclyde Fire Service. Within that control centre, they also covered some 29 island communities across the coast. It wasn't so much the issue about it being in Johnston. They were able to discharge that role very effectively. It was about making sure the staff were properly trained and they had the equipment that was there in order to make sure that resources were deployed appropriately. That's the approach which has been taken by the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service now and also by Police Scotland. And I've got no doubt that they will continue to look at what further improvements can be made to the way in which the contact centres and the operational control centres are working.
Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. If I may just give two examples and limit it to the two. The LEG crew was called out to attend an incident in Skye, 2 hours' journey away and over 100 miles to travel. The RASI crew was called off island on the 22nd of December to attend a road traffic accident on Skye after the ferry had closed because they were deemed to be the closest station. It took them to inform the Dundee control room that it was an inappropriate call out, and the one from Kyle was called out. Surely that supports my contention that we should have a control centre in the Highlands with the relevant intrinsic knowledge of the Highlands and not based in Dundee to sort out the emergency incidents that are faced there.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, the member will recognise that we already have the Inverness Control Centre now moved to Dundee, and there is a piece of inspection work being carried out by the Chief Inspector of the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service over the coming weeks to give us assurance that all of the measures that should be put in place are in place to ensure that the operational control centre is responding to calls effectively. Additionally, the Chief Fire Officer has responded to some of the very specific incidents and explained the way in which there have been, the way in which some of these incidents have come about and the way in which the fire service has addressed these. And I'd be fair to say that the Chief Fire Officer has also disputed some of the media interpretation of these incidents as well. What I can assure the member of is that both the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service and also Police Scotland, that there's significant assurance work goes on regarding the way in which their contact command and control centres in the Police Service and also in the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, how the operational control centres are operating. And that work will continue in going forward. Part of that is also about recognising notable incidents when things do go wrong, making sure that that's properly identified and that they learn from that to minimise the risk of it happening again in the future. And that work will continue to be taken forward both by the police and by the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service.
Thank you. Question 5 has not been lodged. Question 6, Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when the Cabinet Secretary for Justice last met the Chair of the Scottish Police Authority.
Cabinet Secretary.
I last met the Chair of the Scottish Police Authority on 18th of January 2017.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his reply. The Cabinet Secretary will be well aware of the SPA's terrible performance at the Public Audit Committee last week. At an evidence session into Audit Scotland's damning report on governance and financial management of our vital police services, a succession of secret meetings, a letter from Her Majesty's Inspectorate of Constabulary in Scotland that was hidden from members of the SPA, a board member driven out in a despicable manner, all because she dared to scrutinise and carry out her duties. The reputation of the Scottish Police Authority is in crisis, and yet the chair of the SPA says he has no regrets. It begs the question, is Andrew Flanagan capable of turning things around? He has already faced calls for his resignation. Cabinet Secretary, should he stay or should he go?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, there's no doubt the Public Audit Committee will want to consider the evidence which it received from its course of its evidence taking last week and also its future meetings on these particular issues. I'm very clear about the need for the Scottish Police Authority, like any public body, to be open and transparent about the way in which they are discharging their responsibilities. And I've made that very clear to the Chair and to the Scottish Police Authority in ensuring the processes and mechanisms which they have in place are open and transparent. The member will also be aware that I've asked HMICS to bring forward the specific element of their statutory inspection, which was planned for the Scottish Police Authority this year, to bring forward the governance aspect of that in order to make sure that we can have further assurance around the way in which the Scottish Police Authority are taking these matters forward. And once we have the HMICS report on this matter, we can then consider what any recommendations or findings that are contained within that. But I do expect, like all public bodies, the Scottish Police Authority to make sure that it's open and transparent in the way in which it conducts its business, and that it addresses any issues of concern which have been raised with it, and does so in an open and in a way that people can recognise that they are learning from any approaches which have taken in the past that are not the approaches which they should be taking in the future.
I'm going to squeeze in question seven. Mike Rumbles.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what role the Lord Advocate has in determining the competency of legislation.
Lord Advocate.
Thank you. And can I first thank Mr. Rumbles for giving me the first opportunity to exercise the privilege of speaking in this Parliament since I was appointed last year. By law and by the standing orders of this Parliament, the member in charge of a bill has to make a statement that in his or her view, the provisions of the bill are within the legislative competence of this Parliament. In the case of a government bill, the minister will give that statement. Paragraph 3.4 of the Scottish Ministerial Code confirms that that statement will have been cleared with law officers. Law officers consider the terms of every government bill which is to be introduced in this Parliament and provide ministers with advice which enables them to make the statement required of them by law. I may say that law officers also consider legislation after it has been passed by this Parliament. I have the power, should I consider it appropriate to do so, to refer a bill to the Supreme Court of the United Kingdom at that stage.
Mike Rumbles.
Thank you for that, Lord Advocate. But does the Lord Advocate believe that it would also be his duty to refer a Scottish Government bill to the Court of Session that had been laid before the Scottish Parliament against perhaps his advice, but had not received a certificate from the presiding officer confirming that it is within the remit of the Scottish Parliament?
Lord Advocate.
The Ministerial Code makes clear that a statement by a minister that the bill, a bill presented by that minister, is within the legislative competence will have been cleared with law officers. The powers that I have to make references in relation to legislation are those set out in the Scotland Act.
Thank you. I'm glad I made time for one extra answer there. Sorry to all members who couldn't get in with supplementaries. We move on to the next session of questions, which is culture, tourism and external affairs. And we'll start with question number one from Richard Lockhead. Richard Leonard.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it will next meet representatives of the tourism sector.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop.
I'll be chairing the Tourism Working Group on the 18th of May. This high-level group has a strategic focus on the future development of tourism and includes industry representation through the Scottish Tourism Alliance, as well as public bodies with a role in the development of tourism, Visit Scotland Highlands and Islands Enterprise and Scottish Enterprise. This morning, I visited the Visit Scotland Expo in Glasgow.
Richard Leonard.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response? This week, at the 120th Scottish Trades Union Congress in Aviemore, the Labour and Trades Union movement has been promoting a Charter of Rights, a Charter of Rights for a key group of workers in Scotland's tourism industry, those who work in hospitality. A formal launch of the Charter of Rights, drawn up by the hospitality workers themselves, organised by Unite the Union as part of the Better Than Zero campaign, is scheduled later this month, and a parliamentary launch of the Charter is planned to take place here next month. Will the Cabinet Secretary join with me and commit her government to support the Fair Hospitality Charter, including a real living wage, minimum hour contracts, proper rest breaks, equal pay for young workers, and the right for trade union access to organise all workers in Scotland's hospitality and tourism industry?
Cabinet Secretary.
Listen to the member's question with interest. I haven't obviously read the charter. I'd be very interested to see it. I think it's one of the big challenges in the sector to ensure that we can tackle low pay to encourage more people into the sector. There is great career opportunities within it as well. So I think we want to make sure that we have the opportunity to make sure it's a good place to work for everybody involved. And I think it's in that spirit that I'd be interested to find out more about the charter. And of course, in relation to trade union work, the member will be aware that the Scottish Government have committed £250,000 to a Trade Union Fair Work and Modernisation Fund to support trade unions to help embed the Fair Work framework in workplaces across Scotland. But I have the intention to make sure in relation to fair work within the hospitality and tourism sector to take forward that agenda. I think it's a very important one, but we want to see the whole sector grow, but everybody has to share in that growth as well.
Stuart McMillan.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that the themed years are a tremendous example of the Scottish Government and its agencies actually working imaginatively together to help not just the country but also our local communities, and that the 2020 year of coasts and waters can aid our marine tourism strategy?
Yes, indeed. I think it's been a great opportunity for partnership working. I also would want to commend the cross-party group and Stuart McMillan himself for the work on marine tourism. Their work in awakening the giant has actually helped us come to the decision to designate the 2020 year as the year of coasts and waters. And the marine industry and the marine tourism industry has got a great opportunity to exploit that and to make sure that our wonderful coasts and our extensive waters, whether they're lochs or rivers or whatever, have the opportunity to be seen by the many visitors that come from both within Scotland and the United Kingdom, but further afield.
Question number two, John Finney.
Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what value it places on locations in Scotland holding UNESCO World Heritage Site status.
Cabinet Secretary.
We give great status to UNESCO World Heritage Site status. Obviously, we are in the current year of history, heritage and archaeology, and indeed, in terms of World Heritage Day, I myself took part in an event around the Antonine Wall, celebrating the importance of that, one of our six World Heritage Sites. There were Picts and there were Romans in evidence. There was a great Roman bake-off, but innovative and creative ways of helping to celebrate, not just to preserve and conserve our heritage sites, but to make them places for invitation for people to visit is very important.
John Finney.
Thank you. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that reply. The Cabinet Secretary may be aware that North West Highlands Geopark is involved in a crowdfunding project at the moment. And I've asked for an update on that, and I've been told, and I quote here, we are weeks away from having no staff, so the crowdfunder is an urgent attempt to stay afloat. Without staff, we will almost definitely lose our UNESCO status. And as regards the Lough Aber Geopark, the decision there has been deferred until such time as they can secure funding for staff. Now, the UNESCO Wider Value to the UK report published shows that geoparks each provide £3 million on average to the economy. World Heritage Sites, in comparison, it's £2.2 million. Given the ongoing challenges faced by the North West Highlands Geopark, would the Cabinet Secretary agree to meet with me and Dr. Rora Hamlet, the geoarchaeologist there, to discuss how we can resolve this issue in the longer term, please?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the very basic fact that Mr. Finney should be aware of is the geopark is not a World Heritage Site. And that's what the subject of the question is. I've got responsibility for heritage sites. The Environment Minister has responsibility for the geopark in question. And clearly there's been an extensive amount of investment, I understand, in that geopark over a long number of years. I understand there are current issues. So I would suggest that I will ask the Environment Minister, who has the appropriate responsibilities, to respond to the member, because, Presiding Officer, this is not the subject for this question.
Gordon Lyndhurst.
May I ask the Cabinet Secretary, can the Cabinet Secretary provide an update on the setting up of a skills and expertise group within the Historic Environment Strategy for Scotland to resolve shortages in the traditional building sector a sector which carries out vital work on historic buildings within Edinburgh's World Heritage Site.
Scotland's first ever historic environment strategy, Our Place in Time, has been warmly welcomed from people across the sector, and not just obviously Historic Environment Scotland responsible for properties in care of ministers, but also the National Trust, private properties as well. There is a skills group that has been established for some time, and indeed the work that we've embarked on in Scotland is very extensive. The member may not have visited Forth Valley College, he should do. It's one of the investments that we've made where there are building skills, where in terms of the number of apprentices in building skills has been led by Scotland, actually. I think we're leading across the UK in terms of making sure we're training up people with those skills. I'd also encourage the member to visit the engine shed in Stirling when that becomes open, which again will be a beacon. It's been work with the construction skills, but also with Historic Environment Scotland leading to make sure we've got a place that people can visit and encourage people to take up the skills, because the age profile of those involved in traditional skills is such that it's ageing. We need to bring new people into the sector, and I would commend all those that have been involved in doing that and encourage the member to visit the engine shed when it opens in Stirling shortly.
Question number three, Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to draw members' attention to my register of interests and that I'm involved in a hospitality business. To ask the Scottish Government what the impact on the tourism industry will be of the rise in business rates.
Cabinet Secretary.
Recognising the value of tourism within the Scottish economy, we acted to cap non-domestic rates increases in light of the revaluation. Specifically, we targeted £37 million of additional rates relief within the hospitality sector this year. Hotels had been facing an average of 37% of a rates increase after this year's revaluation. That has now been reduced to around 12%, and that has understandably been widely welcomed by the sector, and we continue to engage with them regarding our longer-term approach.
Rachel Hamilton.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. This chamber was told by the Cabinet Secretary for Finance that there would be a cap on business rates of 12.5%. Now we learn the real increase is 14.75%. It will also take 105 days for a decision to be made on any appeal. Why was the industry misled on its rates, and why does the Scottish Government continue to increase financial anxiety within the sector?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we've not increased financial anxiety. We've worked very swiftly to respond to the requests. Obviously, as the member should know, as she declared her own personal interest, that obviously it's an independent rates revaluation. The response by the Scottish Government has been warmly welcomed. She will also know that in establishing and setting out the rate of which the relief would apply, we were consistent with what the UK Government does in terms of announcing and making the announcement in real terms rather than cash terms, and that's consistent with the UK Treasury's approach.
Claire Hawkey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that it's a bit rich for Rachel Hamilton to come to this chamber and play politics over business rates, when organisations like the FSB called the measures announced in February sensible, which should provide some comfort for Scotland's vital tourism and hospitality industries, especially when our own business will save over £5,000 this year? Isn't it about time Rachel Hamilton stopped asking these self-serving questions and started standing up for her constituents?
Can I ask the Minister, Minister to keep her reply relatively brief? I would just ask members not to personally attack other members in the chamber. Every member has the right to ask. Every member has the right to ask a question in this chamber.
I think the member sets out her point very well. I think the point that the industry has accepted and supports what we have provided is one, but I think there is an issue about self-interest of parties and individuals within this chamber, and it's up to them to represent their own interests.
I would note that the member did declare her interest before asking her question. Question four, Ben McPherson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what impact cruise ships docking at New Haven has had on tourism in the local area and on Edinburgh as a whole.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government welcomes the investment Forth Ports has made at New Haven, enabling the harbour to play a growing role in the success of Edinburgh as a key cruise ship destination. With the installation of new facilities this year to allow passengers to disembark more easily, a larger number of cruise passengers will be able to enjoy the numerous attractions the city has to offer, up from 6 in 2016 to 12 vessels due to call in 2017. Scottish Enterprise have recently awarded £79,000 to Cruise 4 Forth as part of its Tourism Destination Development Fund. Crews Forth work with Forth Ports and other partners to further the development of business opportunities from the cruise market.
Ben McPherson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer and wonder, can the Cabinet Secretary confirm what the Scottish Government is doing to support and enhance cruise ship docking facilities and related commerce at both Newhaven and Leith?
I've set out, I think, in my initial answer, some of the investment that's there. Obviously, having the opportunity to have the pontoon development to make sure that more people can come in is one thing. But also, I think it's very important to think about the investments that we have had. The Dazzle ship investment, for example, that marked the Battle of Jutland that was in that area previously. Obviously, in relation to the Royal, the Britannia has had an opportunity to attract visitors for many years. There's Trinity House, there's obviously other opportunities and obviously Leith Links and other places. But in terms of the opportunities, whether it's the Clan Tartan Centre at Leith Mills or indeed the Scottish Design Exchange, I think what we're seeing is a shift and a movement where Leith itself is reclaiming its heritage but also promoting itself as a visitor destination, not just a gateway to Edinburgh, the city itself.
Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I remind the Chamber that I am a councillor of Edinburgh City Council? Clearly, people that arrive will want to visit Leith, but may also want to visit other parts of the city as well. Is the Scottish Government committed to seeing the tram built from where it is at the moment down to New Haven? And if so, are we willing to finance and help that in regard to a project in the next 5 years?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I've been asked about geoparks and now I've been asked about trams, but I do understand that transport infrastructure... I do understand that transport infrastructure is quite often an integral part of making sure that tourists can to visit all parts of the city and beyond. So I'm sure I will take and hear the plea from the member and will refer it to the Transport Minister.
Ian Gray.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with Visit Scotland regarding the Jacobite Trail.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government has not been directly involved in discussions with Visit Scotland about the Jacobite Trail, although this morning I attended the Visit Scotland Expo in Glasgow and had a chance to see the National Museum of Scotland's exhibition and stall about their Bonnie Prince Charlie and Jacobite exhibition. It accompanies the trail that the member is interested in. We've been informed about the trail through the Year of History, Heritage and Archaeology. The trail is primarily a marketing campaign developed and funded by a partnership involving National Museum Scotland, the National Trust for Scotland, Historic Environment Scotland and the Royal Collection Trust as part of their contribution to the year. So the focus of the trail is on those properties and collections held by those organisations such as Doon Castle, Glenfinnan Monument and the Palace of Holyrood House. And that has been supported by the Visit Scotland Growth Fund, and obviously if Mr Gray would like to take additional information or discuss the matter further, that best be done with Visit Scotland and the trail obviously itself.
Ian Gray.
Well, I do appreciate that the Jacobite Trail is a promotion of the partners the Cabinet Secretary describes, but I do have to say that it does seem to those of us in East Lothian ludicrous that the Battle of Prestonpans battle site is entirely omitted from the trail. Now, I'm no Jacobite then or now, but even I think the site of Charles Edward Stuart's most famous victory should be a centrepiece of any Jacobite trail. And more to the point, the Cabinet Secretary must surely agree with me that this is a kick in the teeth both for the Prestonpans Battle Site Trust and the tourist industry in East Lothian. In her discussions with those partners, will she take the chance to make that point?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think the point is well made by the member. As I said in my answer, the partnership has been concentrated on the properties that are owned by those partners that have a relation to the Jacobite story itself. The Battle of Prestonpans 1745 Heritage Trust submitted an expression of growth for expression of interest in the Growth Fund on the 15th of March, and they put in an application to have a creation of virtual reality resources that could be used around Prestonpans. Unfortunately, the meeting had to be cancelled in March by the Trust themselves, but I would encourage that meeting to take place to make sure any opportunities to involve the Prestonpans experience as part of that. But it's not for me as Cabinet Secretary, as I say repeatedly, to tell individual institutions what they should exhibit or curate or what they should not. But in the spirit in which the members made his request, I'll make sure that the partners are alerted to his concerns as raised today.
Bob Dorris.
Oh, sorry.
Question six.
My apologies, Presiding Officer. Caught on the hop there. Question six. To ask the Scottish Government what links it has established with international development organisations working in Sri Lanka. Thank you.
Minister Alistair Allen.
The Scottish Government is engaged with a wide cross-section of international development organisations working across the world, many of whom are undertaking vital work in Sri Lanka. We fund a network of international development organisations in Scotland, which in turn supports the Scottish international development organisations working in Sri Lanka, including Challenges Worldwide, Save the Children and the Halo Trust. Between 2010 and 2013, the Scottish Government provided over £1 million for our International Development Fund for several such projects in Sri Lanka through a number of Scottish organisations, including Police Scotland and Sightsavers. We published our new International Development Strategy in December 2016, which focused our partner countries on Malawi, Zambia, Rwanda and Pakistan. While Sri Lanka is not one of our development partner countries going forward, we are building on the work we supported in Sri Lanka within our new partner countries.
Bob Dorris.
Thank you, President Officer. I'm delighted we reached number six. Can I commend the Sri Lankan Diaspora Community Group, Glasgow Integrated Community Empowerment, International Support, and its chairperson, David Nalaratnam? GICE IS currently raises funds to deliver action to tackle child hunger and boost child education in three rural communities within Sri Lanka. The positive role of the Sri Lankan diaspora in my constituency in Glasgow, Maryhill, Strathmore and across Scotland is also to be encouraged. Can I therefore invite the Minister to meet Mr Nalaratnam and representatives of GICE IS who are based in Royston to find out more about their excellent work and how we can encourage more of this model to take forward supporting diaspora communities that they left back in their country of origin. Thank you.
Minister.
I'm very happy to commend the work of the Sri Lankan community in Scotland and indeed as part of our consultation on the new international development policy, the Scottish Government did hold a specific round table event to meet with diaspora groups. So I'm currently following up on those meetings and will be very happy to include representatives of the Sri Lankan diaspora community along with the countries that we're working with as our partner countries in the near future and look forward hopefully to organising such an opportunity to meet.
Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions. Point of order, Mr Leonard.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. My point of order is against myself. Before asking my question, I failed to direct members to the Register of Members' Interests, which includes my membership of Unite the Union, so I apologise for that omission.
Thank you. And I can also apologise for the misidentification earlier. I was wondering why Mr Lockhead wasn't in the chamber to ask his question. Thank you, Mr Leonard. The next item of business is a debate on motion 5312 in the name of Alison Johnston on carers and social care. I would invite all members who wish to speak in this debate to press their request to speak buttons now.